And thank you so much for being here. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God, we thank you. We ask you to bless all those who are present, their families, their interests that are good, holy, and true. Awaken in our hearts for ever greater desire to know history, to know the way the saints walked the path, often bloodstained, to follow your Son, Jesus Christ. To give us today the most perfect faith carried in these earthen vessels. Help the wounded, church. Help the fallen away, church. Help the Christians who are more holy than the Catholics, that they would be united under the one banner of doctrine and worship. And help all of us be more humble, including your priests and your hierarchy, that we too would be more servant-like and more of instruments in the hands of the Holy Spirit to do God's will. Let's pray for all the sick, the suffering. We have a trip to Haiti coming up. For all the Haitian people, the despairing people, the hopeless people, the mentally challenged people, the suicidal people, the mentally ill people, all the drunks and alcoholics that still suffer, for the law enforcement and for the poor man in Fox Lake who, from their reports, took his own life, the police officer, for his family, for all parents and family members who survived, the victims of suicide. And let's unite all our prayers with the one prayer, with the one woman who stood by him, our Savior, in his deepest, darkest hour of need, and pray for her consolation as we say together, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay, last week, and I'm only talking for 40 minutes because somebody wrote some very pertinent and practical questions that bring 2nd, 3rd century church
development
into practical what's going on today. There was a synod in Rome on the family. There are things going on in dioceses and other parishes that I think we might be able to find some relevance going back into our history and seeing the continuity or the connection with that. Last week I just tried to give a basic overview. The Bible did not fall from the sky. That was one of the larger points I tried to make, that our faith, our religion has characters and has character, has a lot of wrinkles on its face, in its substance is spotless and pure, like the Blessed Virgin Mary, but there's a lot of men and women who are responsible for us getting the Bible in the form that it is in, and having the belief system that we have, and have the teachings that took a long time to develop. And those, what we're trying to emphasize in this course is those fathers after Jesus who comprise the bulk work of the continuity between the time of Jesus, the apostles, and we're gonna try to get to the fourth century, to the 300s. So I'm going to try to get right now in specificity from 33 AD to the year 300 as quickly and as specifically as I can. The notes you have are quite excellent. They are very excellent. I did not write them. Scott wrote them. They are a really good summary of what you were asked to read. So if you did not read it, you can read the footnotes. Excuse me, the cliff notes. Don't ever stay away from class if you don't read the book. Clearly, reading is a reinforcement of what's being taught. And last week it was so general and broad. I was kicking myself the whole way. I thought I should have been a little more book centered. So I'm just going to go and do a short synopsis of how we get to Mary, when is the Edict of Milan? 311 or 313? 311 or 313? Anybody?
313.
313. Okay, 313. Now again, my audience is a Catholic who knows who wants to know their faith more deeply. If there's a non-Catholic watching this, I need one to suspend prejudice and bias. If there's a non-Catholic who gets this tape, if this tape gets into someone's hands, which we're hoping it does, who's a non-Catholic Christian, they must suspend their biases and their prejudices. They must. Because a prejudiced person who is prejudicial towards the history of how we got to where we are through these events and these people will not come to the same conclusions. They will have, if you start with the conclusion before you enter into the evidence and the facts, you will not arrive at the same conclusion. So here is a precursory, quick drive from the ascension. Jesus ascends into heaven right around 33 AD. 11 men. The 12th man was hanging from a rope, who we find out from Scripture fell and split open his insides. That's what Scripture tells us. 11 men were locked up in a room in Jerusalem, waiting for the Holy Spirit. Before the Holy Spirit came, the Holy Spirit comes in Acts 2. In Acts 1, the 11 men come to an understanding of what? What is so important to the 11 men? Another man. The 12. The 12 are significant. There were 12 tribes. That's another key element here. The Old Testament is not to be discarded as useless once Jesus comes. It's still a blueprint that gives us significant fulfillment of prophecy. Buddha and Gandhi and Muhammad were not prophesied with the specificity that Jesus Christ was. And the virgin shall be with child. Isaiah, 600 years before Christ. The lamb led to its shears, silent as a lamb, led to its shears. Beaten beyond recognition. The shepherd shall be struck and the sheep will scatter. And his garment shall not be divided. Not a bone in his body shall be broken. Not a bone of his body. And the list goes on and on. You may know him better than me. Isaiah, the suffering servant. The Old Testament is not to be discarded once Jesus Christ comes. Unlike some Christians, the Blessed Virgin Mary, this upsets me greatly, is not to be discarded after the role she plays in salvation. Some Christians, and I know them, they're good people. She's fine. She played a nice role. Now get over there. We're over here now. No. I'm trying to think of a proper metaphor. I did it last week. My nephews, sadly, never met my dad. There's a way of being a Koutnik. That if you meet my brothers, and you'd be like, hey, he's related to Father Jerry. He's one of them. They're all loud and obnoxious and big, and they carry a certain bravado that my nephews and nieces will never meet. The church fathers are these people, and mothers, but we're going to talk, we say fathers. You know how PC we are. You know how PC we are. It's a small tangent, but I'm going to tell you how PC we are. I was giving a homily on Sunday, and I tried to say, if you put all your thoughts and put them into color, and put all your thoughts as black, and all your good thoughts as white, and I stop myself because I am so been prejudiced by modern media and culture that by saying black thoughts, I may be prejudicial to people of color. That's absolutely pathetic and ridiculous. A man of the training I've received and the education I have should not be caught up with a filter that says, danger, danger. The word black now signifies I am referring to people. It's a color. It doesn't refer to people in the inner city or the president's hair. It's a color. But talk about overly dramatically sensitive. It's ad nauseum. So, should their church fathers? Were there women involved? Yes. But they're the church fathers. So, we know that's a significant point now, because there's no Holy Spirit. The Protestants always refer to the Bible and the Holy Spirit. There is no Holy Spirit. He comes in Acts 2, and there's no Bible. They pick a 12th apostle, Acts number 1. Then the Holy Spirit comes, Acts number 2. And then if you follow Acts, you're going to follow the life of the early church. Acts 12 is in the liturgy. Acts 2:42, the breaking of the bread. Acts 2:46, the breaking of the bread. Trademark. Eucharist, Greek word, thanksgiving, Catholic, Holy Mass. Big distinction. In the liturgy, in Acts 12, Paul was set aside. Hands were laid upon him. And he was sent off as a missionary. And Paul becomes, for us, as we know, as all Christians know, all true, genuine Christians know, the most prolific writer and preacher and missionary of the first century, following Jesus Christ. And he takes off, and if you look at a map, Monsignor does a much better job than me in this, and during the Light of the World retreat, which I'm giving you advertisement for, November 13th to the 16th. If you have not yet gone to Light of the World retreat, it's awesome. And you'll meet a lot of friends, and you'll grow in your faith. But he shows the map how much Paul did in like 25 years. All of Turkey. Look at Turkey on a map. It's big. He turned it all Christian, basically. And into parts of Greece. Christian. So, Acts of the Apostles. Okay, so remember, Peter and Paul have a beef. There's no Bible still. I got to move fast. I want to get to the church fathers. But we all know about the beef Peter and Paul had. Peter and Paul beef. That's a inner city word. That means disagreement. They had a disagreement. Peter, who was a strong Jewish trained guy, thought that Judaism should stay with New Christianity, that a lot of the old Jewish practices should still be observed, like the purification rules, the dietary rules, and the circumcision. And Paul says, no way. No way. Those things are gone. Those things are legacies, and literally, when Protestants accuse us of man-made traditions, those are man-made traditions. They serve religious purposes. Let's be clear. The Lord gave the Jews certain traditions that he instituted for the sake of their religious union. Those traditions were, in fact, because of Jesus Christ, found to be obsolete. Some were. Not all. Those were. Ten Commandments weren't. Especially the sixth one. And the fifth one. I like the ten, but it's the sixth and the fifth I have a hard time with. Well, it's all ten, okay? So, Council of Jerusalem, there's a couple of counts of accounts. There's a couple of counts in the Bible of the Council of Jerusalem. But basically, Paul convinced Peter it's about three things. And it's about abstaining from the meat sacrificed to animals. Because that really freaked out Jews. They followed strict kosher laws. And there were still people offering sacrifices to animals. So the Christians who don't believe in any of that stuff go, hey, can we buy the meat afterwards? We don't care. We just want some meat. We're like, we don't buy your hocus pocus fake religion. Well, the Jews are freaking out. They're like, whoa, that ain't cool. Paul's like, stop doing that. Go to the butcher. Don't buy the meat from these ritual people. And he also talked about natural marriage. Fascinating. It's relevance today. He brought up natural marriage. Remember, what were his exact words? Anybody? I should know this. I'm a horrible priest. I should know this. His exact words. There were three things. One was abstaining from the meat of strangled animals to unlawful marriage. He just basically said unlawful marriage. We're going to talk about that. I want to move fast because that's what the synod dealt with in Rome recently about divorced remarried Catholics and what the pastoral approach of the church should be. I want to get to that. So, Paul won the day. And Christianity, in its most rudimentary form, was born. In terms of what was our message? That's not a question. That's an answer. We put together the Constitution, the basic elemental understanding of this: Jesus Christ is true God and true man. He was born of a virgin. He suffered and died on the cross for our sins. It is a salvific religion. We are sinners. We need help. He came to save us, and he died. He really was dead. It was in the, we give birth to the creed eventually. His death is significant. His burial is significant. He wasn't fake dead like we're going to Haiti on Tuesday, like a zombie. He's not one of those guys. He's dead. And he rose, and he really rose. And the point I tried to make on Sunday with all the saints is, I'll start with myself. We all could think more about the resurrection. Don't get so bogged down in today. I think about the Wall Street crash, people jumping out of buildings. Over money? Over what? Why did you so down on yourself? Oh, you didn't get an A, you didn't get a B, you didn't get that on a cheerleader squad. You got cut from the football team. Come on. Those are Crystal Lake problems. Okay, so we're moving right along. Paul's letters. Remember, these letters are written on parchments. It's not like there's a Bible from Genesis to Revelation yet compiled. Who brings us the first record of the letters of the New Testament? Who is the church father who puts together the first list of the New Testament writings?
Origin.
Around the year, I don't know the year, 200s, around the year 200s. So, this is fascinating. They're floating out there. There's parchments. There are certainly papers and letters. But the idea of somebody in the year 100 having a book in front of them from Genesis to Revelation with a binding is absolutely unthinkable. And yet, that is the most common argument against the Catholic from the non-Catholic Christian. Strong, beautiful, holy Christians persecuting us, telling us we don't like the Bible, we don't respect the Bible, and to think there was no Bible, guys. There was the church doing what the church does, preaching, teaching, baptizing, burying the dead, and marrying, and consecrating, and making priests, and sending out missionaries. All these were undertaken dirt before the writing of the Bible. Okay, there's a persecution in Jerusalem before this. Peter flees to Antioch. We know that from the scriptures. There's a persecution in Jerusalem. He flees to Antioch. Then Stephen gets stoned in the book of Acts. Peter's replacement in Antioch is, we talked about him last week a little bit, is Ignatius. I wrote him down here somewhere. Ignatius, oh, here he is. John the Apostle. Okay, John the Apostle died. Ignatius, okay. Okay, go back a step. Stop me whenever you want. We're moving fast. But this is good, right? It's all dates and times. If you're a history guy, John the Apostle dies around the year 96. Around the year 96. But in 80, this is so significant to me. I'm not a lawyer. This is highly significant to me. John's alive in Ephesus. Clement is the Bishop of Rome. There's a problem in Corinth among the people. They have a young bishop. They don't respect the bishop. So they plea for a authentic, they want their case heard. They want a decision made. You would think, if I'm a Protestant who's a Bible, I'm just trying to get this, the image of a Protestant who's a Bible guy. You would think if the bishop is getting beefed with by this guy, who's his priest, they would go to John the Apostle to resolve the problem. That makes sense, doesn't it? Let's go to John. John's still alive. He's an apostle. He'll resolve this for us. The last time we got in a beef without a Bible, Peter and Paul solved it. They were apostles. Let's go to an apostle. But they don't. To me, that is light bulb on in my head city. They go to this guy in Rome. Well, why? Why would they go to Clement in Rome to settle a dispute in another jurisdiction when they knew where John lived? And they could easily write it. Well, I know the answer. It's rhetorical. Sorry. I apologize. But why would they do that? The answer is, obviously, because the Bishop of Rome already, by the year 80, because Peter and Paul's blood was spilled in Rome, the Bishop of Rome carries with him some significant authority to arbitrate and hear cases regarding the other jurisdictions. They still got the letter. We got the letter. The letter's in a case in Rome. That's phenomenal. That's extraordinary. So Clement settles his dispute. What does he say? He goes on to say what Cyprian is going to say. Respect your bishop. Respect your bishops. Respect your priests. You don't have to get along with us. Every priest has a different personality. And we can't meet all your needs. There's no way possible a priest is going to meet all your needs. Not possible. And I'm really afraid, at least for my sake, another tangent, probably tangent number 75. When I left a seminary, a 6'8" priest named Tom Leland, 6'8". And we're moving our stuff out of the seminary dormitory, and he says, "Well, at least we know now what it means to be a priest, and we get on with our lives, and it's all going to be fine." I'm like, "What are you talking about?" I wasn't really scared, but I wasn't ordained yet a priest. I'm done with seminary. You would think starting your life as a priest, you'd be anxious. Mm-hmm. I don't have the answers. People expect me to be the guru on the marriage problem solver. I'm the local dentist, electrician, plumber. I can do all things and juggle at the same time. Some still think that. But then they meet me and I, obviously, changed their opinion of the priest very quickly. No, Tom says, you just got to know, and I noticed this circuitous logic, but he says, you just need to know one thing to be a good priest. I says, what? No, good try. You need to do what? You got to pray. You got to know one thing to be a priest. I go, what's that? He goes, you got to know what it means to be a priest.
Yeah.
And what that means is, this is the lesser definition, then I'll give you a higher definition. A lot of priests have run around and played social worker. Mm-hmm. And they've given you the idea. Hey, I got a trouble. It's called a priest. And I respect those priests. And we need those priests. I'm just not one of those priests. I never found in my 16 years of priest to be sitting by a phone in an office going, I wonder what's going on in Crystal Lake that I might be able to help. That's non-priestly. There are priests that are like that. I respect those priests. I admire those priests. I'm just not one of those priests. Someone's dying. There's a confession. There's a priestly duty. There's food. I will be, if I can, I'll make it. But you understand, the priest is first and foremost taught. He is a mediator between God and men. He stands as one of you, but also separated from you, to offer gifts and sacrifices to the Father to bring down heavenly remedies and salvific balm for our wounds. And I was talking to a priest yesterday. I had the good fortune of having dinner with the bishop. And I'm really fortunate that I came home after my meeting with the bishop and dinner, and I still have a job. Now, and the mail came today. The mail came, mail went. Tomorrow's another day. But I talked to a priest yesterday, an ordained priest, a very nice priest, I would say by all measures much holier than me, much kinder, much gentler. I says, who did you read theologically regarding the honor and dignity of the priesthood? And he didn't have an answer. Some priests, some lay people, but it would be less your job, it would be more our job. Some, at least I met one, I know there's others, have not read, whether it be Alphonsus Liguria or St. Thomas of Aquinas or Abbot Marmion, on the extraordinary, sublime, majestic order that priests are consecrated into. You remember what St. Francis said, if he saw the Blessed Virgin, an angel, or a priest, he would go to the Blessed Mother first, the angel first, for announcing salvation to the world. He would say to the Blessed Mother, thank you for bringing salvation to the world. And then he would kiss the priest's hands and say, it is you who bring salvation every day to the world. This is not to give me a big head. It's to isolate and sort of focus on the dignity conferred on the man who becomes a priest. Paul reminds Timothy in his letter to Timothy, fan into a flame the gift you received by the laying on of hands. So no, when you receive communion, St. John Vianney said, if any of you knew what you were actually receiving, you would go home in your room, close your door, and cry for 3 weeks out of sheer gratitude. That's true as to with the priesthood. Most priests do not understand, nor do the people who they serve with, what has visited the priest. I could just as easily say, and the church fathers will support me, none of us sufficiently appreciates the gift of baptism, which confers upon us a royal priesthood of the baptized and configures our soul ontologically with an indelible mark to be in the person, excuse me, in the image and likeness of God in such a way we can receive the other sacraments and grow in God's likeness. So whether it's baptism, the priesthood, or Holy Communion, on each level, in each sacrament, we are deeply impoverished as to the true gravity and the high nature of the blessings that come through these vehicles, through these vessels. And what goes on to be our greatest, of all arguments, which is the conclusion of the talk, which I'll get to now, is the succession, as I mentioned last week, from Jesus to Peter, from the 11, was it Matthias they picked? Mm-hmm. Matthias?
Yes.
Then Paul, and then all the way down to Francis, to Bishop Molloy, to the people Bishop Molloy is ordaining now by the laying on of hands. That is known as the apostolic succession from Peter and the 12 to their successors that goes on in an unbroken line of continuity that is highly historically significant and authentic. So, Ignatius we know is 107. He dies in 107. He's got letters. No Bible yet. No Bible. What's he talking about? Priests, bishops, and deacons. Then you got Polycarp. Polycarp has extensive letters. He is in modern day Smyrna, which is, what's it called today? No, it's not modern day Smyrna. It was Smyrna. I'm not talking about Smirnoff. Smyrna. It's modern day what? It's in Turkey. Anyone look it up? It's not Istanbul. I was there. I was in the town. And I should know it. It's Smyrna. It's Isis. It sounds like Isis. Anyway, Polycarp knew John. Polycarp was burned on a fire, and they say the perfume cast off the fire was an odor of grace. Was a fragrance of like they never smelled before. Irenaeus is about, he died on June 28th, I know that, about 170. And he fought the Gnostics. We're going to get to this in a second. All, small tangent, big point. It's not even a tangent, but it's we're a little side story. We got the story straight. Every time someone messes with the church, and we don't appreciate, again, I just gave a list of things we don't appreciate. We don't appreciate our own baptism. We don't appreciate the Eucharist. We don't appreciate the dignity of the Holy Priesthood. The priest doesn't, and the people don't in some respects. We could say that about the Episcopacy. We could say that about the Pope. We could say that about pregnant women. We could say that about moms. Right? Seriously, how many moms get the credit they deserve in this life? Zero. So sadly and seriously, like the priest, like the missionary, stop looking for it. It's just going to frustrate you. Or the dad, the single dad, especially, but the dad too. God will give it to you, and God knows it. Small box side. It's not really a side note, but I'm going here. I don't know why. Every time someone messes with the church in a serious way, the church is forced within herself to think. Well, that can't be true. And we're going to explain to you why it's not true. Every heresy led the church to a deeper self-examination and a deeper explanation. So the Gnostics believed there's private knowledge. So do the Masons. So do the, what do you call it? The underwear in heaven people. Mormons. So do some private revelation Christians. I've had a private revelation. People talk like this. I've had a private revelation from God. You don't know about it. I know about it. You don't know. I know. I know you don't know. I'm special. I know about it. Be careful. Be wary of those people. Remember, if Abraham had a special revelation from God to sacrifice Isaac, and you and I were standing there, we had a special revelation from the natural law to stop him.
Yes.
Don't forget that. The special revelation was just the law itself. We didn't need to hear a voice or have an apparition. We knew from our conscience and the law of nature, we don't kill people. If Abraham laid Isaac on a funeral pyre, we should have stopped him. Because that's what our hearts and our conscience would have told us. Abraham would have said, no, you don't understand. I just had a special revelation from God. We'd be like, all right, come with us. Come on, come on. Right? No one ever thinks these thoughts. The point is, every time someone messes with us at a significant level, the church is forced upon herself to reflect, what do we stand for? What is our constitution? What are the structures? that keep us in place. So, Irenaeus never had a council. He's extraordinarily underrated. If you know this, I will give you no money whatsoever. But what is Irenaeus's most famous of all statements? This is awesome. This is psychology and religion. Self-actualization wrapped up into one sentence, and I'll give it to you. The glory of God is what? Is man, men and women, man, fully alive. Whoa! In 170 he said that. In other words, if you live out the Christian faith as we've been taught it, it will lead you to self-actualization. Our faith lived out to its highest potential will bring all your powers, your intellect, your imagination, your creativity, your work ethic, for some of you, your sense of humor. I'm being funny right now, so you didn't laugh. Your love of neighbor, your patience, I have none. All these other gifts, by grace, they will be elevated to their highest possible level. How about that? That's pretty powerful. The glory of God is man fully alive. And John Paul II's most famous quote from all of the Second Vatican Council is Gaudium et Spes 22, which you should memorize and tattoo into your brain, not with ink, but with a prayerful memory. Only in Jesus Christ does God reveal man to himself. Jesus is the measure of our humanity, obviously. And the consequence, and you're a good crowd. You wouldn't have shown up here if you weren't a good crowd. But some people can't take this. I'm going to assume you all can take this. But if you believe what John Paul II calls his most favorite line, that it is in God that Jesus Christ reveals man to himself most fully, then Buddhists and Islamists and Gnostics and everybody else, I don't care who they are, if they're not Christians following Jesus specifically, they cannot reach their highest human potential. That's a consequence of believing the first line. Wait a minute, Buddhists can't reach their highest possible potential? I would totally respect them, along with all the other religious people. But if we say that Jesus is the measure, we're also saying that these non-Jesus figures are not the measure. Think about that. And that is not being cruel or unjust. If I'm saying Jesus Christ is the one Lord and Savior, the one, he didn't say a way, he says I am the way. I'm not a life, I am the life. He didn't say a truth, I am my truth, you are your truth. He is the truth. If that sentence is true, and God cannot lie, to walk the steps of Jesus is to walk in the fullness of the light and to reach our highest possible potential. And I hope you're living it. And that's why you came here tonight, trying to grow ever more deeper in the image and likeness of our God and our Savior. So Irenaeus is not famous enough as far as I'm concerned. He handled the Gnostics. There was no council. By letters alone, he was so persuasive. He made them realize there is no private special knowledge. There's nothing in the Catholic Church. Think of something in the Catholic Church that's private, that you are not privy to, that is a requirement for your salvation. Of course there's private stuff. I have private thoughts, as you know me, not too many. Not too many private thoughts. But the point is, of course there's private things of the church. There's probably some Pope's diaries, John Paul II, right now the newest book is the Vatican Finances. And I'm on tape, I don't want to say what I think and what I heard. I heard some things, okay, I don't know. But these are humans. Were they playing around with the lira before they became the euro? They might have. Did God bless it? No. Did the church bless it? No. Were there criminals in the church? Yes. Were there abuses during the Crusades? Yes. Was that the main intention the Pope sent them off to secure the Holy Land for? No. Will we all be speaking Arabic right now if the Pope didn't send out the Crusades? Yes. If the United States had intervened in World War II, would we all be going Dunkershane right now? Yes! This is true. So, separate that. So, Irenaeus, 170. Now I'm going to go, I guess. We got Nero in 64, who begins, after Rome burns, he blames the Christians. We have this assault on Christianity. This is one of my big pet peeves. So, from 64, basically, you can go before 64, Because the Jews were already persecuting. Paul was a persecutor, we know. 34, 35, 36. So from 36, you can basically say, they killed Jesus. Start with 33. Right? How did I miss? Hey, sorry, I messed up. I missed Jesus. Start with Jesus and draw a line at 313. So basically, what's that? 20 years. So 280, is that right? 280? Is that right, 280, basically? There was an edict of toleration in 308. There was an edict of toleration. And 260? Galius, is that what you said? Yeah, they came and they went, though. Because Diocletian came after the edict of toleration. The first edict of toleration, he didn't really follow the edict of toleration. Okay. Decius, before the first edict of toleration, was such a bloody, ruthless, systematic emperor that they thought there should be a little pause on the blood. It even got a little much for some of the Roman emperors. Okay, so there were some attempts to quell the wholesale murdering of Christians. But if I'm a non-Catholic Christian, and someone presents me with the facts that for about 280 years, with some pauses, those who called Jesus Christ Lord were subject to brutal torture and death without a Bible, there must have been something else going on that kept them together. There must have been some other source of identity and unity and fellowship and conformity.
Cohesion.
That would have made us see death as not only as a possible alternative, a pleasant one. As we said last week with Ignatius of Antioch, I can't wait to be ground down by those lions. I will be like the grain of wheat, the grains of wheat that are crushed down, made into the bread that is consecrated into the body of Christ. Polycarp, who smelled like sweet perfume. Lawrence, who's being roasted, saying, "Hey, I think I'm done on this side. Turn me over." Think about that. And what about Perpetua and Felicity? The throne to the lions. Who's the servant? Perpetua or Felicity? Felicity is the servant. Perpetua had her servant. I know people who have this even today. My friend Jason. He's got a living Mexican lady. Takes care of the kids. You think she'd speak English by now. She's been here 20 years. I say the Mass in English, she says the Mass in Spanish. Come on, lady, Spain and English. I can say the Mass in Spanish, you can say it in English. Throws us all off. Anyway, so Felicity was the maid servant. Perpetua was the woman of prominence. They went to grab her, they took the maid servant with her. So they threw him into the lions. I think it was Perpetua, I think, was eaten by the lions, and they're all watching. And she was given a grace. Certain martyrs get a grace. This is small t tradition. Okay, now we're getting into the weeds of the Catholic faith. Always know when to distinguish what you have to believe with, and with a small t. This is a tradition of the church, but you don't have to believe it. Fatima was declared authentic. You don't have to believe it. You do not have to believe in Fatima to be saved. You can deny Fatima. I believe in Fatima. I believe in Lourdes. I believe in Mexico. Guadalupe. They are officially sanctioned authentic pilgrimage sites that carry with them indulgences, the church, you know, blessing. But you really don't have to believe them. You do not have to believe what I'm about to say next, but I actually believe it. That certain martyrs at the time of their death, and Perpetua or Felicity, one of the two was an example, was mauled by lions. And when the lions got off of her and her body was crushed and she was bleeding out, she looked up at the crowd and she said, "When are the lions coming?" And they all were like, "Wow." Because certain martyrs were given the grace. Stephen was getting stoned to death. He saw the sky opened up and he saw Jesus. Did he see Jesus sitting at the right hand or standing at the right hand of the Father? Remember that homily? I love that homily for you who don't remember it. Stephen saw Jesus standing at the right hand of the Father. The creed said he sits. But a great priest once said, I have no idea who he was. It wasn't me. I'm not taking credit for it. But a great priest once said, I heard it in a homily. I'm sure he stole it from someone else. No surprise.
Yeah.
So do doctors. Doctors get their information from other doctors. It's in a medical journal. We steal all our material too. Okay, some steal it more than others. But a great priest once said, why was he standing during the persecution of Stephen? When we pray the creed, he's sitting. Because whenever the church is persecuted, Jesus stands and pleads for us on our behalf to the Father. That's cool. He sits with the Father, but when we're being persecuted, he stands. Stephen was like praying for people. Sorry for the graphic nature of this image. There are guys throwing big rocks at you. You see this vision of the heavens open up. Jesus standing at the right hand of the Father, and he's... God, I forgive these people. You know, it's sad. It's like a goofy Monty Python film. I'm not dead yet. You will be. Bring out your dead. I'm not dead. You will be dead. Be quiet. You'll be dead soon enough. It's a long ride. But the grace, so we believe there are instances. Lawrence is another instance. That at the moment of death and excruciating pain, God removes it. And you die without any pain or whatever, you know, the stuff of death, which I think is highly overrated. And I love talking to nurses and doctors who agree with me, most of them. It's the anxiety, it's the emotions, it's what's on the other side. It goes so fast. Mm-hmm. Death is really a fast activity. Vincenzo Mottola just died. Did I tell you what he said? Listen to what Vince, he just died. He died like a couple days ago. We're doing a funeral on Friday. If you don't know Vince, he met Pius the 12th. Small tangent, it's worthwhile. I got a picture of Vincent Mottola with Pius the 12th. He was an occupier in Italy after World War II in the Navy from 47, I want to say, to 52. That's about right. He played drums. So he ran around with the admirals. Pretty good gig. Yes. And he was an Italian fellow with lots of panache. So he's in his 80s, he shows up for Mass every Sunday, he comes right over to me all dressed up. I mean, dressed up. Like, I'm talking dressed up. I can't use the word I'd like to use, but like a nice Italian fella. Yes. Like a nice Italian fella. We're on TV right now. Like a nice Italian fella that I know from your neighborhood. All dressed up. Hey, Father, how you doing? Come on, stay. So I brought him your attention. Oh, because I went to see him at St. Joe's a couple weeks ago in the hospital. He couldn't talk. He's dying from some heart. CPD, CP. COPD, he's dying, and he can't talk, so he says, honey, she goes, don't talk, and his wife, Mary Jane, what a saint, she takes the water out of the cup, and she wets his lips, you know, the little sponge, and like, Father Jerome, it's like, I know it sounds like Vito Corleone, but it's the best thing ever. It's what he said, hey, if I go to your deathbed and you say this, this is pretty cool. He goes, Father Jerome, you go tell Monsignor, I love him. Yeah. You're not supposed to. It's an Italian thing. He goes, I can't hear you. You watch it on TV later. No, he says, go tell Monsignor, I love him. Oh. You go tell Monsignor. He can't talk. And his wife, don't talk. Well, he's going to die. He died. I mean, shortly thereafter, but you go tell Monsignor. I mean, it's like, Jesus is on the cross and he's dying. He's got only so many words. You know the story about his body being brought down. John, take care of my mother.
Yes.
She's dispensable. She played her role. She moved on. We don't need Mary. She had other children. She had sin. People say that to me. It offends me. Mm-hmm. I get offended. These are good Christians. So obviously, our unity within our faith in Jesus must have some arbitration. There must be someone who has a final call. You're out or you're safe. Fair ball, foul ball. Someone's got to do it. And heresies, the early church heresies brought the church into greater unity. I love it when someone says to me, hey, the Protestants do this all the time. It's real simple. You guys complicated it. We tried the kumbaya thing. It didn't work. We all tried to hold hands, sit around a campfire and go, kumbaya, my Lord, Romans are coming. Kumbaya, my Lord, fire is burning. I mean, right? And for all my liberal friends who love, and God bless you, all my charismatic liberal friends who like the guitars and getting all excited during Mass, I just think about the foot of the cross. I just can't see John saying, wait a minute, turning around, putting on a bandana, getting a guitar. Jesus is bleeding, bleeding out, barely breathing. Kumbaya, my Lord. And then Mary doing this. Sorry. We've domesticated the solemn sacrifice of Calvary. That's one priest's opinion. Father, what went wrong? We domesticated it. We made it comfortable. We made it comfortable. I gave a homily today about the beginning of Mass. Let's prepare to celebrate these sacred by calling to mind our sins. I know why some people don't meditate. Because to begin the process of meditation, you got to start by going through your own sinfulness. And that's tough. But that's only first base. Once you pierce through the fact that you're a word, and I'm using my words, these aren't your words. These are more like Luther's words, but let me put some Christianity on it. And a lot of people can't take it. We had different moths, different fathers. But after I meditate, I'm a worthless worm who deserves hell, who hangs but by a string of by God's grace over a burning cauldron of fire and smoke. Then I get to second base, which is, hey man, I dig you, I love you. Yeah, you're a screw up, but I saved you. And I continue to save you. And that bishop, that dinner with the bishop, huh? You got through that, didn't you? You trust me. You trust me. I made a bad, bad joke between dinner with the, I'm going to Haiti on Tuesday. I said this on Monday. I got dinner with the bishop on Tuesday, which was yesterday, and I got a Haiti dinner. I'll be in Haiti having dinner next Tuesday. I'd rather have dinner at Haiti on Tuesday. At least I know I'm coming back. Bad joke, bad joke. Let me tell you one more bad joke since I told one bad joke. I'll tell you another bad joke, and then we'll move on. We're doing good, though. I think we're staying to script for the most part. I'm pretty impressed with myself, for heaven's sakes. And that's quite easy to do, quite frankly. So, Bishop Malloy's classmate from his priestly, it's called the diplomatic corps, where they send priests in Rome, a special group of priests who are a little smarter than the rest of us, to get more education, to go on to be ambassadors. Bishop Malloy was an ambassador in Pakistan. He served in Pakistan as a diplomat, a Vatican diplomat. So his classmate, Barney, was the Archbishop of Haiti, the Pope's representative, the nuncio. Because, in a small story, I have a sabbatical coming up. And people at Daily Mass know this one already. So I wrote to the Archbishop of Ireland, the nuncio, who I happen to know. And long story short is, his name is Charlie Brown. So I said to Bishop Malloy yesterday, I go, hey, your buddy got promoted. He goes, what are you talking about? I go, you know, your buddy from Haiti, Barney. He's now in Rome. He's now in New York. He's the nuncio to the United Nations. How about that for a gig? Talk about connected. Talk about good restaurants. Give me that gig. So what do you want as a job? Make me the ambassador nuncio from the Vatican to New York. I would leave you for that job. But I'm sure there's nice people in New York too. So he goes, I said, so I'm with the bishop. I had too much coffee. Hello. Father Beekman, the pastor of St. Peter, we're sitting there. He goes, it's so funny. We're sitting in his living room. He's got a big living room. He lives in a private home. That's a new thing. And he walks in and he goes, you guys are very early in my house. Mm-hmm. I'm like, well, we're sorry. So I said, hey, your buddy got promoted. He goes, I go, Barney's now in New York. He goes, you mean Your Excellency? I says, yes, Your Excellency Barney. So between Barney and Charlie Brown in Ireland, look who's running the church. Barney and Charlie Brown. Okay, so here we go. Let's end off with this, and then we'll go into some questions, because we already moved to the, we moved fast. We'll move fast, though. Here's what happened. Tertullian is a Montanist. How do you spell Montanist? Montanist. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay, Tertullian is awesome. Tertullian is the one who introduces the church formally to Latin. For my Latin Mass people, if you are a strict adherent of the Latin Mass, God bless you. I wish you well. I ask you to pray for me. But if you think you are following the original Mass, I would say learn Greek. And then once you learn Greek, I'd say learn Aramaic. Because what would he have said at the Last Supper? It would have been a combination of Hebrew and Aramaic. But the early church spoke Greek. The New Testament was written in Greek. Tertullian introduced the Latin. And he ended up, he was great, he wrote a lot of beautiful things. You have them with you. I gave them to you in handouts. Read them. He is a great church father. But he wound up a Montanist. A Montanist is what? It's an early Protestant.
Somebody who believes that the three people, the three persons in God are just personalities.
That's modalism. That's another one. Good one.
Revelation is still different.
First, I'll tell you what she said, which is right. Then I'll tell you how we have to distinguish this. Revelation is ongoing, and it changes. Let's be careful. Revelation with a capital T. You have to believe this. Purgatory, the Immaculate Conception, you have to believe those things. Now, if you don't and you got good reasons why you don't, will you go to hell? Probably not, but you're not living a full Catholic faith. If I was your bishop, I would try to discipline you to get you into the fullness of our faith. I'd want you to believe the fullness of the faith. He descended into the dead, right? He descended into hell in the Creed. He didn't really descend into hell. He descended into the abode of the dead, what's known as Sheol. The just and the unjust before the death of Christ dwelled in the same place. It wasn't until the death of Christ that the just were raised with him and the unjust were damned to a life of eternal punishment. We say hell, well, he didn't go to hell. Jesus did not go to hell. Jesus would not go to hell. The devil cannot be reconciled. These are dogmas. They must be believed. Capital D tradition. Revelation, the fullness, but Revelation as we know it ends with his death. Once, this is very important to know this, and if, sadly very few Catholics know this. Once John the Apostle dies, everything we're ever going to need to know is in seed form. God bless you. Seed form already planted in the church. John 16:12, I will send you the Holy Spirit, he will lead you into all truth. The planted truth about Jesus Christ, the baptism, the sacraments, all the things we need to know to be saved. It does grow, but it grows organically in continuity with what went before it. Nothing new comes in the church's life and existence that in some way is not related by continuity with something that came before it. Give me an example. St. Paul, even if you were to meet an angel of light who told you another gospel, do not believe it. Translation, even if something fantastic happened to you, you bowled a perfect game. You'd golfed and hit a hole in one every time. You actually, and I had a philosophy professor who might have been a true agnostic. He might have been legitimately true agnostic. He was that smart. But he even told me, why do people pray for visions? Don't they realize how awful, using that word in a powerful sense, not like awful, like food is awful, but awful, like how the grandeur of an angel? Does anybody, if you want to see an angel, do you know what you're asking? Weaker-hearted people would have a heart attack. The profound presence of an otherworldly being. If you're constipated, you wouldn't be constipated. Let's just say it that way. Sorry. I don't know who else is that. Constipation. Go on, your question.
There was a Muslim at the hospital who was studying Christianity. He said the thing that bothered him, and kind of touches on this, is that he saw the evolution of Christianity, how it evolved. And are we saying the same thing when we say planted seeds and stuff like that? Because
good.
That bothered him.
Okay, you're onto a good point here, and this is a very important point to get right. Things happen in society. Science discovers things. We thought the Earth was flat, and we persecuted Galileo. The guy lived like a king in the cardinal's residence. I think two of his children became nuns. I know at least one did. Okay, the whole world thought that the Earth was flat. Okay. We thought we met all the known people on the earth. That's why if you weren't baptized, you'd go to hell in the fourth century. Because we thought we knew all the known people on earth. We thought everyone who needed to know knew. We didn't know there was a whole other world out there. So there's new discoveries. Suicide. 60, 70 years ago, the church never buried a suicide victim. Now we do. Why? Neuropsychology. Neuroscience. There are things in the brain that may cause someone to have less responsibility. Who in their right minds would take their own life? Actually, there are some people who do, but that's not my point. That's the outlier. That's the outlier. Most people have a chemical imbalance, have a depression, have a traumatic episode. Well, the church 60 years ago, because of a lack of psychology and neuroscience, we didn't know that. We figured you were guilty of the ultimate self-hatred. You took your own life. So as science progresses, the church can incorporate new discoveries into her already made known teachings, but they can evolve. By that I mean they change organically. It's not something new that never was. It's an addition to something. It's the Adoration Chapel. The church is always here. We added something on that was already here, and we already practiced adoration. We just happened to build a chapel. I'm trying to find a metaphor. But it's not like we grew another limb. Don't think of church evolving in her teaching like growing another limb. We're not growing another limb. It's like a baby in the mother's womb gestating who gets leg first, you know, start, heart starts beating. I don't know how babies are made or how babies gestate. But the body starts forming and the DNA is all present. There you go. All the DNA is present at conception. All the DNA is present by the time John the Apostle is killed. Use this as your metaphor. Now, does it develop? Yeah, it develops, it grows, but always, 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 always organically. There was no confession as we know it in the first and second century. It develops, but we can clearly see its substance in Scripture. James 5:13, tell your sins one to another. John 20:23, whose sins you forgiven are forgiven them. Receive the Holy Spirit. Whose sins you forgive are forgiven them. You put those two verses together, what do you got? You got confession. So what I'm saying is, Tertullian thought things of substance could be revealed to him other than what the church was teaching. And that's a heresy. You are going to get no new ideas. That's why maybe you understand where I'm coming from now. If you got private stuff going on in your life, if I need to know, tell me. Leave a short message. But if you have a message, if you meet an angel, if you go to bed tonight and you meet an angel that says, hey, you're putting on a little too much weight. And like the commercial, your heart attack will happen tomorrow at 9 o'clock. Now, if you know that, let me know. Come on, don't hold out on me. Don't be a jerk. Let me know. If it's coming, it's coming. I'll start hanging around Nimsy. I don't know. I know I got to drink less coffee. I already know that. I don't smoke. Ooh, thank you, Jesus. But I'm just saying. So what's the point? People cling and go after. Some religious people promote it. We do have private religious experiences. We do have ongoing revelations, but never in discontinuity nor disagreement with what's already publicly revealed. How about that? So yes, God speaks to us in a new way today than he did it yesterday. Yes, when I get up in the morning and go to my chapel in the house and open up the Magnificat, he's going to talk to me in a way I didn't hear the day before. So in a sense, yes, there are new revelations. How about it? I said it. In a sense, yes, there are new revelations. Is there any new revelation that in any way is in discontinuity and other than the seed DNA given to the apostles that ended with John's death? No. If something happens to you privately that disagrees with the public revealed doctrine of the church, swear to it. You will deny it. Expose it for what it is. Because St. Paul even said, and on the cathedral in Salt Lake City, it's written on the wall. Because that's what the Mormons believe. It's on the wall of the cathedral in Salt Lake City, Utah. Even if an angel of light should appear. In Latin, the fancy Latin phrase is anathema sid. You know what it stands for? Go to hell. I'm loosely translating it, but that's what it means. And remember, back then, you went to get a haircut. I got a half a haircut. We're talking about the Mets. We're talking about Beyonce or the Kardashians or Bruce Jenner, or I don't know what we're talking about. In those days, they would actually talk about the church's teaching and about what the church stood for. It was constitutionally important to their identity. Today, it's TV shows we watch. We've devolved, not evolved, into a very superficial. So the point is, Tertullian made a lot of great contributions, but wound up outside the church. He did not stay with the unity of the church. I'll move this really fast because I want to get to these questions real quickly. So Novician is a complaining bishop who gets ill. If I get this straight, correct me. Is a complaining bishop against Cornelius? Because what's happening is we're in an age of martyrdom. You already read the story if you read it. There are people getting murdered for the faith. A Baptist told this story in his church. I thought it was a beautiful story. It's a story. But the Baptist preacher comes up in front of his congregation and says, okay, if you all don't leave right now, you're all going to be murdered. And so half the congregation got up and left. And then he looks at those who stayed and goes, okay, for the rest of us who stayed, let's start acting like the church. Very wise. Not everyone took, there was no guns. Not everybody took a bullet, a knife, or the sword, or a beheading, or a drowning, or a torture. And I'm not standing in judgment of them. Some renounced their faith. Some do it now with a lot less intimidation. Some do it now because they're afraid of what a coworker is going to say. Some do it now because they're afraid the boy or the girl in the high school won't think them cool or popular. Some do it now because they don't want to get uninvited to the cool people's cocktail party. Right? This was staring death in the face. And some said, no, I will offer. What the sentence was either you were guilty of atheism because you would not worship their many gods. We had one God. So we would not offer incense to their many gods. That made no sense to us. We have one God. And the Romans didn't believe it either, believe it or not. It's not in the book, but if you push a little further, it was a social convenience. They didn't believe it either. They really didn't. It was a social convenience. It was a social help to stabilizing society. But they themselves really didn't believe it either. But they'd kill us for believing otherwise, because they saw us as an obstruction or a threat and a potential revolution to their order. So we were killed for one of two reasons. Number one, we were actually called atheists. What's the second reason Christians were murdered for? The accusation of?
Cannibalism.
They misunderstood the Eucharist.
Yes.
Isn't that fascinating? Again, I think about my Protestant friends. You guys really don't believe that, do you? Well, they died for it for like 280 years. I kind of think they did. I wouldn't die for something I didn't really believe in. And you know that eating the body and blood of Christ thing? I really don't believe it. Those people I was over at church with, and they're, I'm not with them. They could have said that. They didn't say that. So the point is, the people who renounced their faith were apostates. They were outsiders. They were much like spiritual lepers. Well, Cornelius was trying to get him back into the church. Novician and a group of other bishops says, no, they cannot come back. And another group of bishops says, well, if they come back, we got to rebaptize them. Which is, that's cuckoo. So you can see where confession and the issue of confession starts getting heated up. Because if you were, I hope this camera can see me, and I really only want 10 more minutes because I don't want to put you through all this. If you were a bad, if you renounced your faith and you wanted to come back, your punishment was a public trial and a public penance. You could not receive communion for years and had to sit begging in front of the church for the orphans. Who has this number? who is calling me on this number? Let's finish this. So, we got a problem, and we'll finish with this. Then we'll do one more question. I'll leave you alone. And thank you for putting up with me. You're good for my mental health. We have a problem with lapsed Catholics. We still have the same problem today, which is why they had that synod in Rome. Think about this. Why did they go to Rome to meet? There are many opinions. But one opinion was divorced Catholics who remarry outside the church feel abandoned and feel marginalized and don't feel the need to go through the full decree of nullity process. So how can we either short circuit or make a pathway? That's one opinion of what happened. How can we make a pathway for divorced Catholics who get remarried outside the church and gay married people? What is a pathway to Holy Communion? Now, go back 1700 years. You renounced your faith, but you realized you made a mistake. You know, that's I saw the blade of the knife. I saw the executioner. I froze. I do love Jesus. I would die for Jesus. Small note, we never think that when we receive communion, do we? Body of Christ. I could just as easily say, will you die for Christ? Yes, I will. Amen. Doesn't sound like that, but that's what I'm saying to you. Will you die for Christ? Because that's what they did. And they did. They were killed. So those who wanted to come back in the faith, Cornelius was trying to figure out a pathway for them back. Now, divorced, remarried Catholics, they got to fess up to their first marriage. Otherwise, they're living in adultery.
Right.
You can't have... Look, here's how I explain this. Your first marriage, if you're divorced, remarried in the Catholic Church, that's your business. I'm not here to put any guilt on you. And the church doesn't put any guilt on you. There are abusive marriages. There are alcoholics who could be horrible people who you might not have known they were drunks, became drunks when you married them. They were psychologically immature. They were serial daters. They lied. They had a hidden psychopathic personality. They were murderous. They were abused. Whatever it may be. You could honestly think of a case where this couple is better separated. I've never used the word divorce to a couple in my entire priesthood. I've used the word separate. I know what's going to happen. I know what that may lead to. But and I've never, ever said to a couple, hey, you need to divorce this person. Because I believe in miracles. I believe God can change people. And they did get married in the eyes of God. So what they need to do, obviously, is simply put, sorry, Val. I married Valerie, and we broke up, and then I married someone else. So I got to take the blessing off of this marriage and put it on the other marriage. Otherwise, I'm still married to her. And I have this other wife. I'm a polygamist and I'm living an adulterous life. That's what I'm doing. There's no way to shortcut that. So, that is a proposition and a consideration that took place in Rome. One aspect, there were other things. Of what do we do with these people? And in my humble, simple opinion is, discipline them. Sorry. The Eucharist is worth waiting for. The Eucharist is worth, sorry if it's called jumping through hoops for. The Eucharist is worth the time it takes to do the full annulment process. And everybody I know, every single person I know who's gone through the full process. I got a guy right now. It has been so healing.
Yes.
And brought such resolution to them. It is like a public confession and healing and forgiveness. And that spouse I married who I thought I loved. And you know what? In some ways, I still do. God forgives me through the church. I'm moving on. And there's no easy way to slice this onion, folks. If I keep you in a bad marriage, I'm an ogre and an archaic, overt conservative. If I let you all out too quickly, I'm a progressive, a liberal, and I'm no good. The church can't win on this topic. And people abuse, clearly. The decree of nullities. They abuse it. Where they could sacrifice a little more, be a little more open to feedback, be a little more patient. That's why I'm not married. And work these things out. But having said that, this was a big fight in the church, and Cyprian came in, and I'm going to end with Cyprian. Cyprian came in and did some amazing writings that he preserved on the unity of the church, the teaching on the Eucharist, what you need to be in the state of grace and have a a disposition and be in the unity with the church, obeying, and a lot of other requirements and not footnotes, but structures that you could point to exist today in our modern day worship and our community living that I think are extraordinarily impressive. Their precise continuity and the way they carry forward in today's church. Any questions? How'd I do, okay?
Oh, yes.
Better than last week, I think.
Yes.
So what we'll do is we're going to lead to, what's interesting is, once we legalize Christianity with Constantine, who has a dream, and you should read about it. He had a vision. I'll leave you with his vision. He has a vision where the Lord says, in vincen, what's it, in vincen, in, I don't know the Latin, I should know it. I used to have a t-shirt. It was a lamb with a big flag. With this sign, you will conquer. What is it? In vincenze. In the sign. In vincende signal. My brother. I have a brother, Frank, who always says, you know what? You can make up Latin all the time. They would never know. In vincenze chair gincincio. Which in Latin means... With this sign, you will conquer. And he won a very big battle. And he established himself as the rightful heir apparent as the emperor of Rome. And then united the East and the West because he came from the East. And one of the first things he did, because of his mother, Helen. And what's Helen famous for? Finding the true cross. And she happens to be my mother's name. And I always thought as a child, I went to St. Helen's Grammar School to name the grammar school parish after my mother. I'm almost 50, I still believe that. And I'm sure she was immaculately conceived. And even though I have three other brothers, I know she's still a virgin. So, having said all that, thank you for listening. We're going to pick up again at 3:13. Well, to next week, no. I'll be in Haiti the following week. But thanks for showing up. And as Larry Hennessy, a retired priest from Mundelein, who was a patristic teacher, would say, and always say, if you do not want to know, your faith will not grow. So thank you. And I'm running out of here. So you need to call me? Call me. If you have a vision, make it quick. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God, I thank you and praise you for life, for love. Bless my tactical officer friend and all his partners and all those who serve and protect. And all the criminals and all those who are on the fence with choosing criminality. That God would bless the inner city people and all those in middle and high places that are tempted to do bad things, especially at the expense of good people and innocent people. May God's grace be upon all of us, that we be more awakened to our inner dignity, our baptismal graces, and the most awesome treasure of the Holy Eucharist. May God unite all Christians and bring the world under one form of religious government, which is under the one true shepherd, Jesus Christ. And may all of us do more to promote the true and genuine faith. And may God give us the grace of final perseverance, that through temptation, persecution, and even death, we would remain faithful to our Lord and Savior. To be able to see him one day face to face and be like him and see him as he is. May God's choices, blessings, and protections be upon you. And may the Holy Spirit's grace fill you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Okay, thank you very much.